Welcome back and welcome to Let's Talk Autism with Shannon and Nancy. As I mentioned a little earlier, it's just Shannon today because Nancy, unfortunately, we've made her stay home because you know her, she's an Energizer Bunny and she would be here otherwise, but we told her she had to stay home. She has been not well and is pretty intensely not well, and so we've threatened her. And told her that she had to stay home. And if she's watching, we just want to tell her how much we love her. And everybody send her your best well wishes because she needs to get on the mend. But in any case, I'm here and I'm going to be with you throughout this hour. We've got a great show. We actually are going to jump right in with licensed and marriage family therapist Vince Redman, one of my favorite people on the face of the planet. He's right there. Hey, Vince, how are you?
Good morning.
Vince, I just want to take a second to say I was thinking about you last night, and this summer we had the opportunity. I got to be around you more than in one stretch than I'd gotten to be around you before, and I got to be around you with my son.
Right,
and
it was
a very fun time, and as if I didn't love you before, and I thought I couldn't have loved you more, but when you get to be around somebody and see them in action, and we were at the Autism Society of America conference in New Orleans, and one by one as parents came up to the table and were talking to you, I just got to see more of you in action, and I just loved you all that more. So I was thinking about you last night and how amazing you were to all the parents and how amazing you were to their kids and how amazing you were to my kid. And I just had warm fuzzies for you, Vince. I just think that you're a remarkable person.
Oh, thank you. We got to do it again. It was fun.
Yes, it was very fun, although it was hot.
It was very warm.
Ooh, humid, I guess, is the word for it. But yeah. In any case, Vince, we're so thrilled that you're here with us. And for anybody who hasn't seen you before on the show, we want to say again that you're somebody who has worked in the field of autism, first as an ABA therapist for decades, and that you are now also a licensed marriage and family therapist. And I can't imagine anybody who would be better at that for an autism family because you have that experience. You know, I know early on when we started ABA therapy, we went to a therapist and I was frustrated because I didn't think she understood what we were doing in our home.
Right, right.
And it was really, really frustrating to me because I felt like I was spending half of my time with her explaining what it was we were trying to do. And her response to that was, well, gee, that sounds really stressful. I think you should dial it back. Mm-hmm. Which was not helpful. So we love that you exist. We love that you are a resource for our parents who, you know, so that you understand how difficult a family dynamic can be, but you also understand what families are trying to do with an ABA intervention. So thank you for being.
Oh, no problem. And you're right. I mean, it's a lot of education. And if the therapist or the counselor doesn't have the background in the field, it could take a while to get them caught up on really understanding the tensions and stress and anxieties that families like yourself experience on a day-to-day basis.
And saying, you know, maybe you shouldn't do this if it's so stressful, not useful or helpful to anyone.
No.
So I encourage people to get help and support, but if you find that you're coming up against somebody with that kind of an idea, make sure you connect with somebody like Vince that gets it. But so Vince, you know, since we're here in almost mid-December and we're cozying
holidays.
Up, yo, big time holidays. And for everybody else, it's supposed to be this time of peace and joy. I don't know how much that there is of that left in our commercial holidays, but especially for autism families, it can be a time of heightened sensory issues. It can be a time of, you know, family intrusion, and just more stress and sometimes less services. So help us, Vince, to know how we can deal with the stress, the additional stress that comes with the holidays.
Well, there's a lot, like you said. I mean, you have schedules changing, you have new people, you know, relatives and such that might be in town and integrating in with your family. You know, we have just the change in schedules, right? I mean, being in school and then the kids now not being in school, you know, and then you have the hustle and bustle of taking them out and about in environments that oftentimes are a lot more busy, a lot louder, a lot, like you were saying, much more sensory oriented, you know, that could be very confusing and difficult for a child. And the biggest thing that the advice I could give, and I know we're already into December now, is looking at those situations and planning ahead as best we can. The more we can have at least a predictable schedule for the kids, the more accepted and the less anxious they will be, even though that might break routines, right? We have most of our kids have difficulties breaking their routine. So if they're not going to school or what have you, it's difficult for them to really understand what's going on. However, when we use schedules or we use a visual schedule or we use, you know, whatever level your child is at, we're able to then show them this is what this week is going to look like. So now we're talking, you know, the week of December 19th and on, which is when, you know, winter break typically happens. So these are the activities we're going to do this day. We're going to go here. We're going to go there. We're going to do this. You know, so really scheduling and going over the schedule with your child, I think, is definitely a good idea to do, so that they have time to process. They have time to think about what's going to happen. And then when it happens, then they know that the schedule actually is kind of foretelling them what is going to happen, so that it's not as much of an anxiety, because that anticipatory anxiety, because they don't know what's going on. So that's my first recommendation.
Okay, so a visual schedule where you can literally get the calendar down or make a schedule for the day to show them exactly what's happening.
What we're doing.
Yes, I think that's such a great thing. I think we all forget, because you know what? It feels like another task for us, so it feels like it's gonna take us more time to do that. But I always remember when I'm in the car with my husband and he's giving me directions to go someplace and he doesn't let me know when the next turn is, I wanna kill him. I love that man, but I wanna kill him, because I need to plan. I wanna know what's happening. I wanna be the captain of my own destiny when I'm driving a vehicle. And I think about our kids and how frustrating it would be if you started your day and somebody dressed you and dragged you all over the earth and you didn't know when it was gonna stop.
Right. And if they're dressing you in the morning and you're thinking you're going to school and all of a sudden you get in the car and you turn left instead of right, you're like, whoa.
Yeah.
You know, in our kids have difficulties, you know, not only processing their emotions, but yet alone communicating those. So that can oftentimes lead to some of those vocal or physical outbursts that the kids might have. And it's not because they don't want to necessarily go where you're going. It actually could still be a preferred location. It's because it wasn't processed. It's because it was last minute. They didn't have time to change their mind, to get ready for what that change is going to be. And that's really the intent behind the visual schedules, is to give them time to process, give them time to understand that their day is going to be different.
Love it. Okay, so visual schedule, but I interrupted you because you had another one that you were going to give us.
Well, just kind of going down your point. So there's that. So now we're talking to talk a little bit more about family, right? This is obviously the best time of the year. We get family together and we love spending time with each other. However, sometimes we have family members that really just don't understand some of the parameters, some of the behavior interventions that might be in place to work with our kids, right? There could be, you know, behaviors or attention seeking behaviors, non-compliance, what have you. And what I suggest that we do then is we know who those relatives are. And I oftentimes talk about, you know, creating kind of a cheat sheet for them, you know, so that they can have that ahead of time to understand that this is what is going on. It could be dietary restrictions, it could be behavior modifications, it could be just maybe some of the reinforcement schedules that we or strategies we use. You know, he gets a token for this, or he gets a high five for that, you know, so that there's a little bit of more information that they have, rather than on the spot, again, going back to what we were saying earlier, rather than on the spot saying, no, don't do this, do this, right? Then we're dealing with conflicting emotions, we have a little bit of embarrassment, we have a little bit of confusion. But if we're able to give them some information, just basic information, not full BIPs or full, you know, treatment plans, but we're giving them just the basics information that they can do, they'll feel more competent and comfortable interacting with your child or children.
Yeah, I love that, Vince. I love the idea of getting them prepared, giving them a cheat sheet ahead of time. There are still going to be some family members who just can't keep their mouths shut. But I know this from the past, when you have done everything that you could, you know, there's that whole thing, the serenity prayer about, you know, grant me the serenity to know that, you know, accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. When you've done what you can, everything that you can, and you gave them a cheat sheet, then it clearly comes under the heading of stuff that you cannot change. And for some reason, it like diminishes the anxiety that you would feel around it. And the other thing, I don't know whether it was you or somebody else who told me years ago, other people's opinions of my parenting are not my business. And I, like, when I'm in a position where a family member is going, well, you know, you shouldn't let him get away with that, and da 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 da, I think of that crocheted onto a pillow. Other people's opinions of my parenting is none of my business, because it doesn't help me in the least.
Right.
It makes me stressed out if I spend the time to think about it. So I love preparing them, but we know that there will be some parents, or there will be some family members, who they're just not going to get it.
And sometimes it's just, you know, you just let them go.
Yeah.
You know, it's not worth the fight. It's not worth the battle. And you know that it's not going to be long term, so where there's going to be any regressive, you know, effects of their behaviors on your child. And you just try to, you know, just minimize the amount of interactions they have as much as possible. And then you just let it go.
Yeah.
You know, it's not worth the anxiety that you feel. It's not worth the anxiety that they feel to try to fight it. If, like you said, if they're just not willing to change, and they're not willing to use the information that you've given them, my suggestion then, you know, especially since in the holidays, it's usually very temporary. You know, you have your one thing, or your Christmas Eve party, or your Christmas Day party and gathering, and then that's it, right? It's already, you know, going to be over, and it's not worth the anxiety to continue to fight it if they refuse to change.
Yeah, you know, over the years, I keep coming back to the idea of expectations, and that everybody around the holidays has expectations. Everybody, whether they have a child on the spectrum or not, about what they're going to eat, what it's going to be like, who's going to be there, what they're going to give, what the reaction might be, what they're going to get. People have a lot of expectations around the holidays, and I feel like then when you have a child who's on the autism spectrum, the expectation thing gets a little squishy, because you still have the expectations that, you know, you want the perfect holiday, but you have fearful expectations too, and it gets a little on the wonky side. What advice do you have for us about dealing with expectations?
Well, it depends on what the expectations are. Sometimes it's good to talk about those expectations with your supervisor or you know, your team, to see if those expectations are realistic. Are those expectations that can be met? Because if they are, then that's great. Then as a unit and as a team, we can continue to work towards either the child for those expectations or the parents towards those expectations. However, if amongst, you know, conversation and discussion, feel that those expectations might be a little high or a little low, that's the opportunity then to normalize the expectation, maybe to come up with a different expectation list so that we can shoot for those goals instead, right? But communicating those expectations will help, you know, really regulate if they are too high, too low, or they're just right.
Okay. Any other, we're running out of time, Vince, any other last minute holiday advice?
No, I think the biggest thing is try to keep the kids included as much as possible with things that they're gonna feel good about. Make sure there's a lot of sensory integration for our kids that are very sensory, sensitive. Make sure we have opportunities for them to get out, run around, make sure that you bring sensory things with them, if needed, weighted vests, blankets, those types of things, so that if they're not in the comforts of their own home, you'll have opportunities to be able to give them some of those sensory, because oftentimes, even though they're happy and they're excited and they're getting a lot of good interactions with family members and friends, it's good to be able to regulate that sensory. So I would definitely make sure that you guys are packed and ready to go.
Love that. Vince, We adore you. We hope that you have a wonderful, happy holiday season, and we'll look forward to seeing you in the new year.
You too, guys. I wish you happy holidays to everyone. And again, thank you for all the questions and everything. And I hope that we continue to make a difference.
Absolutely. And you always do. Thank you so much, Vince. Bye-bye.
Take care.
Bye-bye. Really appreciate Vince Redmond. And he is the head of Card Family Services. I didn't mention that before. And a remarkable human being and a fabulous, for those of you who are Card families, you know, you always have Vince as a person that you can reach out to if you have stuff that's going on. And he has family specialists in each office that you can also reach out to as well. Remarkable human being. I'm playing already. This amazing thing that I'm holding in my hands is the Makey Makey. And this is the toy of the day, you guys. And I absolutely am so excited about this toy. So we're gonna take a break and then we're gonna come back and we're gonna have we're gonna feature the Makey Makey and have somebody from Makey Makey and Joy Labs that makes Makey Makey be here with us and talk about what this thing does, what it can do, and how this came to be. If you've got kids who are really into computers, and like to take things apart and invent things, oh my goodness. This is a great gift and it's got a wide age range on it if they have that skill set. So stick with us, Makey Makey coming up right after these messages.
What would you do if your child was hurting?
If your family's future was uncertain?
If help seemed out of reach?
Have you been given no hope?
Talking means I am not alone in this.
This is the reality for families affected by autism. And today, the number of children with autism is growing more rapidly than ever. Talker unites these families, ensures that they do not have to fight this battle alone.
Our oldest son, Jared, who has autism, when we first took him to the doctor to get the diagnosis, you know, it's so sad because they offer you nothing. There's no help, there's no hope.
One of the things that you learn with autism is being very grateful for even the small milestones. You know, when you first get the diagnosis, you go through all the range of emotions. You know, this can't be happening. Why is this happening? You have to get to a point where it's the emotion that has to be leading is, what can I do? The first thing that struck me was walking to a room and seeing, oh my gosh, we're not alone. And there is this very strong community that's already set. And something I still today associate with TACA the most is hope. To me, that's what TACA means. TACA means hope.
It's like you've got all these dreams and goals of what your son's gonna do, and you get your diagnosis and you're sent home. And that's it. There's no plan of action. There's no, here's autism, here's what we're gonna do to make your life better and help him. It's strictly go home and try to process it and go on the internet. It was devastating, and you just, you know, you go through this 3 week of depression and then you snap out of it, you have to. And then you start making phone calls and trying to figure out what is autism and what are we gonna do? And then we found TACA, and it was life-changing.
Autism, there really is no definitive answer. It is trying to find the resources that are out there that can assist you to help your child so that, you know, you just don't feel so helpless at those particular moments.
There was direction and there was hope and there was a little ray of sunshine that he's gonna be okay and we're gonna be okay. I always look back and think we would never be where we are. Carson wouldn't be where he is at without TACA.
So 13 years ago, my son was diagnosed with autism and that put our whole family into a tailspin. There were so many different ideas and things that were not proven. Nobody knew what guidance to give us. We had no direction. And then we found TACA. They helped give us a path to follow, help give our son a better future and make him healthy and put him back onto the road of recovery. When your son's first diagnosed, the first thing you hope for is, gosh, I just want my son to speak. I just want to be able to communicate with him in some way. Then you want a little more. You want him to go to a regular school. Then you want him to potentially have a real life and go to college. So you're always hoping for the future of your child. My son is a happy, healthy, vibrant young boy that's going to turn 15 really soon, and we couldn't be more pleased. And without TACA, I don't think we'd be in the place that we are today. We believe the future is not defined for many affected by autism. There is hope and direction for these kids and their families. TACA is dedicated to providing community, support, education, and hope to families affected by autism.
At TACA.
At TACA.
At TACA.
We are families with autism helping.
Helping.
Helping, helping families.
Helping families with autism.
Hi, my name is Matt. I am 19 years old, and I was diagnosed with autism when I was 6 years old. Autism is one of the fastest growing developmental disabilities in the United States, but I am living proof that with the right treatment, hope is possible. My future is not limited. Today, I am attending Fullerton Community College, and I run for the cross country team for fun with my friends. It makes me feel proud when I think about my progress. Chances are you know someone affected by autism. Show them they are not alone and help others get on the road to recovery. Contribute to Talk About Curing Autism today.
Welcome back to Let's Talk Autism with Shannon and Nancy. I'm so excited because it's finally time. I've been talking about this for a month, ever since they agreed to come on the show. We are now going to talk about the makey-makey, the thing that I'm most excited about at this holiday season. So joining us via Skype is Liam Nilsson. Am I saying your last name correct? And he is from Joy Labs. They are the company that make Makey Makey. He is the Vice President of Community Engagement and Development. Liam, thank you for being here. Because I have been just ridiculously excited about this little thing called the Makey Makey. I've been mentioning it, teasing it to our viewers. It looks like something out of a Frankenstein lab. I've got the demo model here, and people can see the bananas sticking up because bananas are a great way that you demo this. So, Liam, what is this thing, this Makey Makey that I'm in love with?
Sure. So the Makey Makey, it's funny that you said it looks like it came out of Frankenstein's lab. It actually came out of the MIT Media Lab.
Okay.
Which is, you know, also a very interesting lab. The Makey Makey is a construction kit, is what we call it. So it works actually just about the same way as a computer keyboard works. Right? When you're pressing a button on your keyboard, when here, you press the space bar down, right? You're just completing a circuit when you press that button. And that operation doesn't have to happen inside your keyboard, you know, for that circuit to be closed. You can use anything that conducts electricity if you use a Makey Makey. You just connect something from ground here to the arrow keys or space bar or click or any of the things on the back. And so anything that conducts electricity, like bananas or people or cats and dogs or, you know, straws filled with water or, you know, copper tape will work. So Makey Makey is actually a portmanteau of make and key, because you can make anything.
I get it. Well, and, you know, it's one of those things that you can explain it until the cows come home, but right. People, I loved as you were thinking about, well, okay, here are all the things I can hook it up to, and the list becomes endless, which I think is part of the joy of Makey Makey,
yeah.
Is that you can hook it up to so many things in so many different ways that it literally is mind-blowing. So I, rather than us keep talking about it, I really want our audience to see, and so I think we should go to some video of some of the many different things that you can do with a Makey Makey, and then let's come back and talk about it some more, okay? Liam?
Sounds good.
Okay, so take a look, you guys. This is just some of the things that you can do with a Makey Makey.
Hi, I'm Jay.
And I'm Eric. We're graduate students at MIT Media Lab.
We have a dream
that everyone is an inventor.
So we created Makey Makey to let you invent just by alligator clipping. Alligator clips stuff like bananas to your Makey Makey. When you touch the banana, your computer just thinks you're touching the keyboard. The front has arrow keys, spacebar, and mouse left click. When you're ready for more, flip the Makey Makey over and you've got more keyboard keys and support for the mouse. You can even use the board like an Arduino when you are ready. No programming, no breadboarding. You don't even have to install software. Just plug it in USB.
Order your Makey Makey today and start changing how the world works.
Okay, I'm in love. I love this thing. Because this, to me, is a bridge that puts endless capabilities into people's hands. And so I absolutely love this. I don't even know what to ask about Liam because the questions are so endless, right? But I must say that there are endless videos on YouTube that you can go down a rabbit hole seeing all the different ways that people have been creative with this. Even I love Googling just art and Makey Makey to see what people do with art with this. That's my favorite thing. What has been your favorite thing that you've seen somebody do with the Makey Makey, Liam?
Oh, cool. That's a really good question. There have been, that's actually probably my favorite part about working with Joy Labs is getting to see all the projects that people make. Right off the bat, somebody made this really great project that MJ, the co-inventor, talks a lot about, this trampoline-powered slideshow advancer. The Tech Museum out in California has this thing called the Makey Makey Collabathon, where these teams of two people play this game in a basketball stadium where they have to connect points A to points B, C, and D using these giant boxes covered in tinfoil.
I love it.
Yeah, a lot of gallery artists have used it to create really interesting things. There's somebody down in Mexico that made this project called El Arbol, or the tree. There's this tree that you could go up and touch the different leaves and different sounds and lights would come on. There's a lot of really interesting games that people have made, you can, of course, make like a Mario controller out of Play-Doh, like in the video.
Right.
But the things that I think that are really cool are, the things that you couldn't do with a keyboard, right? Like making buttons that are so not shaped like buttons that you would never, even think of them as a button. Like, hitting a hanging tinfoil ball from the ceiling with a foam sword covered in tinfoil. I think I have it right here, or like a sequencer made of conductive ink. So here's a bunch of conductive ink, which of course you can use graphite like in the video. Conductive works a little bit better. Here, you connect a different note to each of these and you just run your finger down this track and it'll play the whole scale, or it'll play, a drum sample if that's how you've set it up.
Wow.
It
literally is mind-boggling. And I gotta say, in the right hands, this opens a whole new world. And it's really important to me to mention that this was not invented for kiddos who are on the autism spectrum. This is a really cool item that's available for anybody. You put an age rating on it of 8 and up. We recently had a director of a film who was on the show, and anytime somebody has come into my office, I've said, have you seen this? Have you seen how cool this is? And I was showing it to him and he was like, oh my gosh, I got to get this for somebody in my family. I don't want to say too much in case they happen to be watching. And I said, are they a teenager? And he said, oh no, he's like in his 20s, but he would love this. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's really at the heart of the matter. There are so many people in your life who would love this, but I do want to take a second to talk about how powerful of a tool this can be in the hands of kiddos who are on the spectrum, especially our teens who are so into computers. Because a lot of times when you're on the autism spectrum, there is some issue with flexibility and flexible thinking. And when we help those teens on the spectrum to massage that flexibility into inflexibility, we see that there is true genius available there. That a lot of times they're functioning on a rule set that somebody gave them arbitrarily. And when we tell them, oh, there's this much more room for a rule set, you open up all kinds of doors. And that's what this does. It takes their computer and throws the rules out, but gives them a set of circumstances that are cause and effect, right? Which is great, easily understandable, color-coded. I love that all the alligator clips are in different colors so that you can easily trace back what you're doing and why it's happening. And that allows for creativity, a thing that we're always wanting to get more at with our individuals who are on the autism spectrum. I gave this to my son, who's on the spectrum and 13, and within 20 minutes, he had so many different things going on and was having such a ball and was hooking it up to things and different things. I knew that it was going to be something that was great for him. I'm so excited about this item for so many of our kids, Liam.
Yeah, I think it's great. I mean, I think it's great. It's like it. The kind of medium of the message of the Makey Makey is that, you know, a banana is not just a banana. And, you know, a bowl of water is not just a bowl of water. And it's like, you know, to attach different pieces of software together, you use code. And to, you know, really easily attach physical things together, you use, like, glue or duct tape. The Makey Makey is like duct tape that connects, you know, the computer world to the physical world, you know, very easily.
And, you know, and can I tell you that a part of how I found you guys was that somebody had said to me, I was asking, what kinds of things do you get somebody who's into computers but doesn't yet know how they work? And they told me to look at getting an Arduino board, and I didn't know what that was. I Googled it, and this came up. I still don't know what an Arduino board is, but I saw on your thing that it says, when you're ready, this can function as an Arduino board. Do you know what an Arduino board is?
Yes, sure. So the original Makey Makey was built on what's called an Arduino board, which is like a very small, simple, you know, computer, micro processor. They're actually made in Italy, or Arduino first came from Italy. The new Makey Makeys are a bit simpler. So before, if you wanted to change what the outputs were, because all of these things can, like, it starts out as arrow keys and space and click, but if you want to change this to be, like, volume down and that to be volume up, or you want this to be, you know, left click and you want that to be right click, you can do that. Before, on the original boards, you had to download this Arduino software and recode it. And now it's much simpler. You just go to makeymakey.com/remap, and then you can change the outputs there.
Wow. So obviously, you know, this is something that can grow with an individual. If they find it exciting, they can figure out more things to do with it. The list really is endless of the things that you can do with this. I know. Yeah. Already we had a parent who wrote in last night when we said we were going to be featuring it. They said they already ordered, they saw we put your video up on my Facebook. They saw it and said, oh no, we've already ordered it based on what we saw, because they want it for the science fair this year to figure out all the things that they can do with it. It's an amazing, amazing thing. Where can people buy it, Liam?
They can just get it on makeymakey.com is the easiest place. And we ship all over the world. Yeah, that's the cookies.
And it's a pretty affordable price point on, and you have different versions of it as well, correct?
Right. So there's the Makey Makey Classic, which is, that's this one. That's the one we saw the video of. And there's two different boxes of that one. There's like a retail box, which is a bigger box. That's the one that we sell in stores. You can also find it at like Toys R Us and Barnes & Noble and a couple of other places. And so that's where you get the slightly bigger box. But then there's the one that we also sell on our website, which is the same thing, just in a smaller box, so it's easier to ship. That's both the Makey Makey Classic. And then there's the Makey Makey Go, which is a smaller one that just has one button that it can turn things into. And it works slightly differently. So there's only one alligator clip instead of two. It uses what's called capacitive touch sensing instead of resistive touch sensing. So it's more like a touch screen, whereas the Mickey Makey Classic is more like a keyboard.
Got it. Fascinating. So all those places to check it out. We want to thank you so much for the work that you guys do. We are so excited about this. We're hoping that those of you who get a Makey Makey, that you'll become part of the Makey Makey community. You have a lot of people posting videos of the things that they've done with the Makey Makey. I encourage everybody to check those out for inspiration, but then make your own videos. And if you want to, you can send them to us. We'll share them here, and then we'll share it with Makey Makey.
That sounds great.
Because we think this is an amazing thing in our kiddos' hands. And honestly, they really don't have to know anything because it's very much a plug and play. But I think you'll find that even if you've got a kiddo who isn't that much into computers, if you demo this for them and try it, they're going to get more interested. I really honestly believe that. We think it's absolutely genius. Genius toy. So thank everybody at Joy Labs. We also want to thank you guys for participating in our Sensitive Santa. So there were kids that that got Makey Makeys at our Sensitive Santa, and we're going to be giving this one away. So stay tuned to the show to figure out how you can enter to have your child win this one that I'm just demoing here away. Liam, thank you so much, and thank everybody at Joy Labs. We think you guys are brilliant.
Thanks so much for having me on.
We're thrilled to have you. Have happy holidays. I hope you do bang up business.
Thanks.
All right. Bye-bye, Liam. Thank you. Okay. And so again, that is our toy of the day, Festival of the Toys, toy of the day, Makey Makey. We're going to take a break and come back to cover some in the news and our mindfulness moment, so stick with us. We're very excited because we're in the Noah's Ark exhibit and we're here with Jason Porter. Thank you for taking us on this tour.
Oh, thanks for having us.
So you're going to show me around a little bit and show me some of the secrets of the Noah's Ark exhibit, right?
Yeah, I'd be happy to.
Cool, let's go.
Yeah.
So Jason, tell us, this is an amazing space. Why is it so incredible for children?
One of the values of the Skirball Cultural Center is taking care of the earth and one another. And so this idea of repurposing materials that would otherwise be tossed off was a big component to how we designed the galleries. It's based on, you know, certainly the story that everyone knows is the one from the Hebrew Bible, the story of Noah. But in our research, we looked at over 200 flood stories from around the world. And, you know, many different cultures have flood stories that have similarities. And the similarities that we identified were these three chapters: the storm, some crazy challenge that comes to your life, an ark, a kind of means of survival, a way for a community to come together to survive, and finally the rainbow, which is this kind of symbol of hope, the second chance to make the world anew.
Love it. All right, let's take a look through, and we're going to talk about some of the learning opportunities that are available here.
Sure. We really wanted people to kind of discover what they were supposed to do. For example, this elephant has a gong in the center, and there's a little wheel here that you can turn and see what happens. But there's also some hidden things, like there's a little peephole in this polar bear, so it's kind of a moment where you could talk with your kids about what does it mean that that polar bear in there only has a small piece of ice to live on, it, and you could talk about kind of the environmental issues that might be associated with it.
All right, should we go downstairs?
Yeah, let's check out the storm.
So Jason, what do you call this room?
This is called the Storm Gallery. In one side of the gallery, we have a storm wall, which is all sorts of sounds and sight effects to make the storm come to life. But we have this, what we call the load up. It's fairly intuitive. You know, you put animals onto the conveyor belt and you turn the wheel and they get loaded up onto the ark. Except you can't do both at the same time by yourself. It's kind of layered in the doing, the learning that we're really interested in, which is about this notion of working together in order to accomplish something. So, you know, when you first get on the ark, obviously you enter two by two, as the story goes. So the animals in this first section of the ark, you know, they're not quite sure where they should be. They're a little bit nervous about who to hang out with. The gallery is really organized so that the the animals are still in pairs. So we talk a lot about what are the elements of home that you need to survive. And it's really a nice kind of intro into the whole experience of being in a community, learning to be together with people who may or may not be the same as us. This gallery of Noah's Ark is unique, I think, in terms of the way that it was designed, that it offers a huge variety of experiences in a way that really accommodates people of all stripes and spots. So there are more quiet zones, like we just left in the move-in day, where you can come into this room where you have a lot of large motor things that are happening, including climbing, and we kind of have nicknamed this the arcade. It's kind of the chapter in the story where they're making new families and they're mixing with other animals that they've befriended. Oh, we have to talk about poop.
We can't do a show without talking about poop.
So, you know, the other fact of life on an ark is that everybody poops. So the challenge is to, you know, clean up.
Okay, so we're in the last room, very cool room. What do we call this room?
We call this the Rainbow Gallery. You know, people really get that this is a place of hope. Sometimes there's an art-making project that it ends in some sort of inspiration, that people feel like they're inspired to take action in the world and make it a better place.
Thank you so much for showing us everything and telling us about all the wonderful things at the Skirball Center. Welcome back to Autism Live. We have been covering in the last month or so a story that continues to just find new lives. There was after this summer when Donald Trump got the nomination at the Republican convention, there was a lot of chatter in the autism community about some of the behaviors that Barron Trump exhibited. And I, like a lot of people, thought it was gonna die down and go away because in my opinion, it was inappropriate. And which I've talked about here on the show. It didn't die down, and Donald Trump won the election and is now our president-elect, the chatter went right? And we did a video here about that, urging people in the autism community to please use common sense and to use good behavior and model good behavior about not overstepping and projecting things onto other people regardless of what you think, especially entering it into public opinion and public entering it as if it was fact that there may or may not have been a diagnosis warranted. And we urge people to stop that. Then, of course, at that time there were a bunch of videos, but there was one video that kind of rose to the top that was very incendiary. And, you know, last week we covered the fact that Melania Trump did hire a lawyer who then pursued the person who had posted that video and said, you need to take it down, that it's inappropriate. And there was discussion about suing him. Rosie O'Donnell, in the meantime, had come out and tweeted that video, and she has since apologized. But why are we not leaving it alone, you're asking us? Well, because Forbes didn't leave it alone. Forbes, one writer in particularly, Emily Willingham, who writes a lot on the topic of autism on Forbes, wrote an article that is out this week that says Melania Trump threatens to sue autistic man over a YouTube video. I want to encourage people to read this article. I found it really ill-informed. And a lot of things I took issue with. Shocking, I know, I never take issue with anything. But the first sentence of this, which I'm not sure whether this was actual writing from Emily Willingham or someone in the marketing department of Forbes decided that they would put this in as the thing that would get us all to click on it, but it says on Forbes.com, Melania Trump is reportedly incensed over the posting of a YouTube video alleging that her son is autistic and had a lawyer threaten to sue the autistic man who produced the video. The video went viral after Rosie O'Donnell tweeted at Donald Trump about it, saying, what an amazing opportunity to bring attention to the autism epidemic. Okay, let's back up a little bit. Melania Trump is reportedly incensed. I want to know who reported that, because we all got the same statement from the lawyer, and I don't remember there being anything about being incensed. I recall that in it, it said that this needed to stop, because it did. It was inappropriate. And even in this article, Emily Willingham says that it was inappropriate, although now that everybody knows that the person who did that video is on the autism spectrum and he has stated what his intentions were, suddenly people don't think that that video was as incendiary as it was. I saw that video. It was incendiary. And you know, motive is a lot. Motive and intent are a lot. And I do believe that the gentleman who was on the spectrum who made the video thought that he was doing something positive, saying stop bullying him, because there were people saying a whole lot of other stuff about him based on the behaviors. But the way in which this video was portrayed, where it would pause, it would rewind, it would pause, it would rewind and show the same behavior over and over and over again. I understand what his intention was, but I think that any parent would have said, not fair, not appropriate, take it down. I know the irony here that I am siding with Melania Trump does not escape me, right? But I'm sorry, before any party lines, I'm a parent. And parents need to be allowed to defend themselves about inappropriate behavior. And even when it is at the hands of a person who is on the autism spectrum. I take issue with the fact that, you know, she says who's, at the end of the article, she says who's bullying who. But, you know, when we have this attitude about saying that people who are on the autism spectrum, we want to be able to allow for some behaviors and to allow that our world is not theirs, and we don't want to just condemn them for their behaviors, but we also don't want to say to them, oh, it's okay for you to bully a child because you're on the autism spectrum and you didn't realize that you were doing it. That's not appropriate. This is the same argument that we got into about Jeff Sessions' speech to Congress. We don't just excuse behavior. That's not where it's at. And he has taken responsibility for that video and put up an apology and taken that video down. And I commend him for that. But now to go after Melania Trump because she stood up and said, what you're doing is not right, really, really angers me. And it threatens me as a parent. We all need to have the right to defend our children. So to say that she is now bullying him, I think you're stretching this story into something that it isn't. I also take issue with the fact that she calls out Rosie O'Donnell, excuse me, getting over a cold, for calling autism an epidemic, and she says, which it is not. I'm tired of this. And she says, and the term is offensive to autistic people. Yeah, to some people on the autism spectrum, it is offensive. And you know why? Because for the longest time, we have been told not to use the word epidemic because epidemic is when an infectious disease spreads. But the truth of the matter is, if you look up the definition of epidemic, there in Merriam-Webster, there is a secondary one that says an outbreak or product of sudden rapid spread, growth, or development. And if there is not a spread of a development of autism that is rapid and growing, I don't know what it is.